Hugh Kennedy alleges he was sexually abused in the 1970s by Australian priest Father Dennis Alexander.
I really would like this man to come back, face justice as he should.
Dennis Alexander denies he abused children in Scotland. In 2013, he was confronted with the allegations at home in Sydney.
I don't care who you are, mate. Just get off my property or I'll call the cops, okay?
The 154-page report found that between 1970 and 2015, the church received more than 3,000 complaints of child sexual abuse from over 1,750 victims and complainants, filed against more than 900 people connected to the church. The report also noted that sexual abuse was a continuing trend, not just a historical one, with more than 100 allegations of abuse being reported every year since 2016. In reference to historical accounts, the report uncovered the church's maneuvers to protect alleged perpetrators by shuffling them between different parishes while failing to support victims and survivors. It highlights the case of Father James Robinson, who was moved to another parish after complaints were made against him in the 1980s. After fleeing to the US, he was eventually extradited back to the UK and ultimately convicted in 2010 for 21 sexual offences against 4 boys and was sentenced to 21 years in prison. One survivor reported that between the ages of 11 and 15, they'd been abused hundreds of times by a priest, and after every instance, they were required to make confession. Another case was revealed of appalling sexual abuse inflicted upon pupils at Ampleforth College and its adjoining junior school in North Yorkshire. Furthermore, one particular survivor who provided evidence to the inquiry claimed that thousands of pounds had been spent by the Diocese of Westminster to employ lawyers to keep victims at an arm's length while they built their case. Lawyers representing the victims, as well as activist groups and support groups for survivors, have called for the immediate resignation of Cardinal Nichols. As per the Vatican's Code of Canon Law, Nichols did in fact offer his resignation to the Holy See as he was almost 75 years old, but that resignation offer was due only to his age and not due to the surrounding scandals of covering up abuse. Ultimately, the resignation wasn't accepted by Pope Francis, who, in turn, instructed Nichols to continue as cardinal and as leader of the Catholic Church in England and Wales. The report documents a shocking amount of abuse, but also notes that the true scale of misconduct is likely far worse, and that many more cases may remain undocumented.
How often did this happen?
It was just something that was so frequent, so common, it was sort of what we expected to happen.
It was normal.
It was normal.
It takes, I'm 40 now, and it's taken me this long, last year, to come to terms and actually accept that this was nothing more than depravity.
Would you like an apology from the Archbishop of Canterbury on behalf of the church for them not taking action?
Yes. I'd like them to explain that simple humanitarian processes were not in place, regardless of legislation, regardless of all the red tape. You know, someone's been hurt here. Let's deal with that. You know, let's do something about it. Let's be the church that we've been for 2,000 years, helping other people. Where is that? It's a complete contradiction. It's made me really consider and wonder about what the church is all about.
Never occurred to me to tell anybody. When the head teacher's been abusing you, who do you tell?
Because you don't know what I feel inside me. You don't know the hurt I am. You said 'twas non-adversatorial. My God. 7 barristers throwing questions at us, non-stop. I attempted to commit suicide. There's the woman who saved me from committing suicide on my way down from Dublin after spending 5 days at the commission. 5 days I spent at the commission. They brought a man over from Rome, 90-odd years of age, to tell me I was telling lies. That I wasn't beaten for an hour, non-stop, by 2 of them. By 2 of them, non-stop, from head to toe without a shred of cloth on my body. My God, Minister, and could I speak to you and ask your leader, would you stop making a political football of this? You hurt us when you do that. You tear the shreds from inside our body. For God's sake, try and give us some peace. Try and give us some peace and not to continue hurting us. That woman will tell you how many times I jump out of the bed at night with the sweat pumping out of me because I see these fellas at the end of the bed with their fingers doing that to me and pulling me into the room to rape me, to bugger me and bait the shite out of me.
Put it into a cupboard in my head and I shut the cupboard door.
I think it's too late for me. I don't think I'll ever get any, if you like, justice for what happened to me in that school because I think the elements are gone. I think the evidence is gone. I think the people are gone. Particularly, I think the perpetrators will be gone.
I think it's affected the way I relate to people, that my emotional state, my psychological state. I think it fucked me up, basically, emotionally and psychologically. I don't let people touch me. I cut my own hair. I don't even let a hairdresser touch my hair, you know. So it's had quite a devastating effect in terms of how my life's been. It's always there.
But with me, it was the headmaster, John Burns. He would send somebody, go tell him I want him in my room. And I'd go in and he used to make me take my clothes off and then he'd pull me onto his knee and he'd start interfering with me.
And was he disrobed at this time as well?
No.
So he was still fully clothed?
Yeah.
But you were naked?
Yeah.
And he started touching
your penis. He used to play with himself when he was doing it.
He was playing with himself, yeah, as well as you?
Yeah. And then he'd say, put your clothes on, leave. That was it. He never spoke to me or anything. But every time he did it, I absconded straight afterwards.
How many times did that happen?
Probably 8 or 10 times.
So quite a few times.
Yeah, yeah. You couldn't get away with it these days, could you?
No. Did you ever say anything to the police or any of the authorities about what had happened to you?
Nobody.
Why did you not?
I don't know. I think we were all ashamed of it. Because they're all preaching all the time. It was a Catholic approved school. And they were forever going on about God and Jesus and church and all this, and then doing that, you know, which goes against everything.
So do you think that the church were involved in some sort of cover-up?
They had to know. You know, they had to.
Les went to the police. By that time, both of the men he says abused him were long dead. He's had constant nightmares and flashbacks and has been diagnosed with PTSD.
I stopped going to church.
You lost your faith?
Lost my faith. Yeah. You see how the church in Boston tried to sweep things under the carpet. And you read about cases in this country and other parts of the world. I lost my faith. Yeah.
I will preface this with a story. As I went on Sunday to St. Patrick's Cathedral and went and attended Mass, I spoke to a number of Catholics there after the Mass and asked them what they thought about the Pope requesting that people please forgive us for what we've done in the past. Every single person that I spoke with said we would only hope in one way, shape, form, or another that the Pope is more proactive and goes after some of the problems and helps to clean up the Catholic Church and make us proud of the Church again. Can he be that proactive? And at this point, what can he do?
Well, I beg to differ with these people. Maybe it's because I do this for a living. We've averaged 7.6 credible accusations against 40,000 priests in the last 6 years. This problem, which took place, which was an utter disgrace, was between approximately 1965 and 1985. That coincides with the sexual revolution and then the discovery of AIDS in 81. What I'm saying is that this problem has largely been checked. There's a major problem in other demographic groups of which the media have no interest in pursuing, never mind the public schools altogether. So what can this Pope do about what? I mean, I don't know of a single institution which has less of a problem, proportionately speaking today, than the Catholic Church when it comes to the sexual abuse of minors.
The calls keep coming in, nearly 500 so far. to a hotline set up by the Pennsylvania Attorney General after that grand jury report, which detailed how the Catholic Church covered up the sexual abuse of more than 1,000 children by some 300 priests for decades.
I would get high before I would have to serve mass so that I could separate myself from what was about to happen to me. And I was in charge of the altar boys. I got to make the schedule. I would schedule myself so that others didn't have to take it. I did. I did it so that other people didn't have to take it. Because I knew I was stronger. And I knew I could disconnect.
My abuser used to say mass in our kitchen.
In your kitchen?
In our kitchen.
Where you grew up?
Yes. In our kitchen. I was abused for 20 years. And you ask how I separated the two? I split. I had one of me that handled the abuse, and the other one was just myself.
Arthur, you're here to speak for your son, who's no longer with us. But you can continue to give him a voice.
What kind of a parent would I be if I didn't continue my struggle and fight for my son? What kind of a person, a man, any human being, would even think about molesting a child, let alone somebody who claims to be a representative of God?
Why do you think this is such a problem in the Catholic Church? It's not just Pennsylvania.
Nope.
It's not just the United States.
I think it's gone on because it was allowed to go on. They knew, these guys knew they were going to be covered for. They knew they were going to be moved. They did it because they could.
Is there anything that the Catholic Church could do to regain your trust?
No.
Not today.
Not
today.
No.
Are any of you still, do you still consider yourselves Catholics?
Oh, I'm Catholic.
No.
No.
I'm not.
I go straight to God.
The Jesus that I learned about in school would not turn his back on children.
Right.
Not once.
Everything they taught is a lie. I mean, there's no other word. There's no other word.
I can't walk into a church today. I get a knot in my stomach. I would never be the same since.
He turned to alcohol. He says he was rotting away inside. In 2003, Mike McDonald took his story to the church. In 2012, he went public.
By sharing it, I'm exposing myself. I'm letting you in on some deep, dark secrets. But it does help. It helps the cause. It helps the survivors. It helps current victims. It helps advocates who have been fighting alongside of us for a very long time. And it helps me.
Helping others is also of vital importance to the man we meet here at the iconic Hotel Bethlehem near Allentown, Pennsylvania. John Delaney, one of the first Catholic Church sex abuse victims to come out publicly in the U.S. in 2003. His story includes dozens of cases of abuse by priests, drugs and alcohol addiction, incarceration. But something else troubles him most these days.
Everybody does think priest abuse is strictly with boys, but it's not. And I fear that maybe there's a lot of female victims who have yet to come forward and speak out.
Around 400 more people have called the victims hotline at the Pennsylvania Attorney General's office since the grand jury report was released.
This Pope is visiting a completely different country to his predecessor.
I want to hear him loud and clear recognize what the church has done to the citizens of this country.
People have a deep sense of faith, but they're just not connecting with church.
To Pope John Paul, Ireland was sacred ground. When he visited in 1979, contraception, divorce, homosexual activity and abortion were all still illegal. The church held sway. They used to call it Catholic Ireland, a place of pilgrimage for the faithful, but not anymore. The land of saints and scholars has witnessed a social revolution. The church that once controlled this state now battles to find a place within it. The last bastion of Catholicism became the first country in the world to legalise same-sex marriage by referendum. It then voted by a landslide to lift the ban on abortion.
Yeah, we're certainly a different place, and this Pope is visiting a completely different country to his predecessor. What I see is a Catholic Church that wants to actually consolidate a more conservative base and pursue an ideology that is very much out of step with how people are thinking. The more they pursue that, the more meaning the Church loses for people in this country.
The number of Catholics has dropped from 95% of the population in 1961 to 78% today, but few attend Mass on a regular basis. The Church has fallen from grace, vilified for 9,000 reported cases of child abuse by priests and for imprisoning single mothers. Immortalized in the film The Magdalene Sisters, 30,000 women were locked away. Delia Mulryan spent 30 years of her life in a Magdalene laundry.
I feel very, very sad about it. Like, I couldn't bear to do that to an animal.
This kind of tells the story of Ireland. You know, you got religion on one side, but you had what was going on inside this laundry.
That's right, indeed. Where the poor mothers would be slaving from 7 o'clock in the morning until 7 in the evening. Can't lift their head from what they're at. Boring work, couldn't even talk to one another, communicate, laugh or joke. It was so sad, environment to be in.
Peter, what was their crime? What was your mother's crime?
She had a baby out of wedlock. That's simple as that. And when you think of what the Church did itself to those little children when they got a chance, the way they treat them was horrible, and they got away with it, what they wanted to do with them.
And they have the completely wrong view. They think, you know, that the Church doesn't care, that they're just shut down, and they have their own opinions of what our beliefs are. And some of the times, those opinions and those perceptions are wrong. Like, say, for example, the most one that we get from a young person is, why does the Church hate gay people? The Church doesn't hate gay people, you know. And I think that's really important for the Church to put that message out there, you know. We have to be all-inclusive. We have to welcome every single person.
The Church is desperate to reconnect with thousands of cultural Catholics who only attend Mass at Christmas or for christenings, weddings and funerals. So will Pope Francis have something to say to those who suffered most at the hands of the Church?
I want to hear him loud and clear, and to recognise that he understands what the Church has done to the citizens of this country, which I'm speaking about. What it has done to them, to the vulnerable people. They were supposed to show respect. The Pope is here to represent God here on earth. And it's far, far, far light years away from what they're doing.
What would it mean to you, Peter, for Pope Francis to say, I'm sorry for what the Church has done to people like your mother and you and your sister?
Yeah.
What would that mean to you?
It'd mean an awful lot. I could close my eyes in peace, but as it stands, I cannot.
The discovery that some 800 babies had died at a former mother and baby home run by the nuns in Ireland, and that their bodies had been put in unmarked and horribly inappropriate graves, shocked the world.
It's a sewage tank. Why are their children buried in a sewage area?
The religious orders are back in the spotlight. The government has called an inquiry, the sixth into what went on behind convent walls.
They won't inquire properly because I know what the government are like.
The report last year into the Magdalene laundries run by the nuns was a whitewash, say the survivors.
They took my life, they took my human rights, they took my hair, they took my clothes, they took my name, and they also took my daughter, which was the worst of all.
The survivors want the new inquiry to also look into their story and for the nuns to be held to account.
All I wanted was, please, somebody to give me an apology for what happened to me.
Will this latest inquiry tell the whole truth of the suffering of those put in the care of the nuns? Survivors of a home run by the Nuns for Single Mothers in County Westmeath gather for a reunion. They are the lucky ones. They survived.
There was thousands of babies born here. There was hundreds of them died, and I remember the nuns carrying down the little brown shoe boxes to bury the children. And when the workman buried those little babies, he put nails in the wall to represent each child he buried.
Now the government has announced yet another inquiry into the mother and baby homes. These survivors say they won't be fobbed off.
We have found our voice and we're not going to be silent anymore.
They're angry because they say earlier reports, like that into the Magdalene laundries, failed to tell the full truth of what really went on in Ireland's religious institutions. Questions began to be asked when, back in the early 1990s, the nuns who owned the vast High Park Convent in Dublin wanted to sell the land where now there's a car park. The problem was that the plot they wanted to sell, which back in 1993 looked like an empty green field, was in fact filled with the bodies of former laundry workers. I tracked down the gravedigger employed by the nuns to dig them up in County Kildare. He agreed to give his first television interview.
Well, the nuns were trying to sell the place, and it was big money, like, so they didn't want anyone to know what was going on. It was all hush-hush. We were supposed to tell no one about it.
The nuns told him there were 133 bodies buried in the plot.
When I said there was more bodies buried there, they said, no, there's only 133. We start digging then, where I thought there was. So we kept digging and digging till we dug out the whole lot, and we ended up with 22 more that we weren't.
So
we didn't even know they were there.
22 bodies that the nuns didn't even know were there.
Didn't even know they were there.
And he found something else inside the grave.
A lot of plaster of Paris, which was on their wrists, and their arms, their legs, their feet, their ankles. There were broken arms and broken legs. It seemed to me like. The women were too small, they were too frail for that kind of work.
There was shock at the story of unrecorded burials and corpses with broken limbs. People began to ask what had been going on in the laundries. The few pictures that exist give a rose-tinted view. No sign here of the crippling work described by survivors. Thousands of women and girls were sent to work unpaid to a network of laundries all over Ireland. They were sent by the state, by their parents, by local priests, and if they were orphans, by the nuns. Mary Merritt was born of a single mother in a mother and baby home and was sent to an orphanage, which were run by nuns in Ireland for most of the last century. One day when she was 11, she was so hungry, she took an apple from an orchard. She was sent to work in a laundry in Dublin.
They took me to High Park Convent and they left me there and they said, now you stay there until you learn to stop stealing.
And how long did that take?
I was 14 years there. I went there on the 7th of January, 1947, and I came out of there in September, 1960.
Did you ever ask why you were there for 14 years for stealing an apple?
Yes, I did ask them, and I asked, was I ever going to get out of here? Am I going to die here? Because some of the women had been there for 56 or 57 years, and I thought, am I going to be the same, and I'm going to have to die in this place? One of my jobs was to help to lay out the women when they died. I was happy to do it because at least these women were getting out of the laundry and their suffering were over.
Sue, that was my friend, Mary Breheny. She worked for the Magdalen Laundry for 56 years.
I moved on to Waterford, where I learned you didn't have to steal an apple to get sent to a laundry.
So what do you remember as you walked down these corridors?
Elizabeth Coppin had been abused by her stepfather and was sent to an orphanage run by the nuns. They took her out when she was 14 and put her to work in a laundry.
The first Magdalen laundry I was in, it was a nightmare. You worked from 8 in the morning to 6 at night, every day except for Sunday and bank holidays. Oh my God. You know what? This brings back so much memories. It's changed and yet it's the same. We used to have to go to confession once a week here. The priest would sit in here and we would go in here to tell the sins that we never had. I mean, what sins would you commit anyway?
You didn't have time.
No, you wouldn't have time to sin. If anything, they were committing the sin against, they were torturing us. They were the sinners, not us. This is where we came every single day for Mass, the Magdalen women and girls. We had to come here, even if we were sick or not. I mean, you just had to.
As more such stories come to light, the more the Irish public demand to know how this catalogue of arbitrary detention and slave labour was allowed to go on until the last of the laundries closed in the 1990s. After all, the government was paying for women and children to be cared for in these institutions.
It was when the United Nations Committee on Torture called for an investigation that the government here agreed to an inquiry, but with the narrow remit of looking into state involvement into the running of the Magdalen laundries. When Senator McAleese brought out his report at the end of last year, there was widespread criticism.
Survivors were astounded to read that the McAleese report decided to not make specific findings on the issue of living and working conditions in light of the small sample of women available. Despite the harrowing testimony of many women who complain of ill treatment. Elizabeth told the inquiry she was put into a punishment cell at a laundry in Cork after wrongly being accused of stealing sweets.
I was in there for 3 days and three nights till they decided I'd learned my lesson for something I didn't do. But that was, again, it was all about mind games. It was just controlling you.
When Elizabeth tried to run away, she was sent to another laundry with an even stricter regime.
They shaved my head and I had to wear a uniform. So straight away your identity is taken because my name's changed, my hair is cut and I'm not wearing my own clothes. And I'm stuck in there and I have to answer to the name Ender, which is a man's name. So how do you cope with that at that
age?
Why
do you think they did that?
Just to dehumanize me, to make me feel nothing in society.
Mary also tried to escape. She broke a window and ran into the town, where she begged a priest to help her. He raped her.
I'd never been out in the world in my life. And I had no idea what was going on. I was crying my eyes out and I said, "You're hurting me." Then when he was finished, he said, "Now, this is between us. I'm going to give you sixpence," he said, "and this is between us," he said. "Don't tell anybody." I said, "I'm only trying to help you," he said.
The police took her back to the laundry. Mary says she also told McAleese how the nuns didn't believe she'd been raped. They put her in the punishment cell for running away.
One of the nuns came down then and she cut my hair to the bone. And then I was taken up And I was made kneel in a room with all the women there, kneel down, kiss the floor and say, oh, sorry for what I did. And promise not to do it again, which I didn't promise, of course. But she said to me, you have to, I said, no, I'm not promising you anything, I said, because I want to get out of here, I said, and I might do it again.
Many girls and women interned in the laundries tried to run away. I went to Limerick to meet Gabrielle.
This is the wall I tried to escape from many times, but in those days they had glass all along the top, so there was no chance. So then in the end, I remember falling off, and I've still actually got the scars to prove it.
Gabrielle was 17 when she was sent to the laundry here. Her mother asked the nuns to stop her running away with her boyfriend, and they obliged by imprisoning her.
This was the yard. It was kind of like an exercise yard. You know, you'd walk around, because that was the only exercise you got, really. And you'd just walk around for I don't know how long. But that's
like
where we
prison.
Would do it. Yeah, it's the same as a prison. They work the same system.
Gabrielle didn't do the laundry. She was put to unpaid work, making the famous Limerick lace now on display in the City Museum.
We would be making lace from 9 a.m. till 6 p.m. And they would have the American market. They would have holiday makers, if you like, coming over, coming into the convent, looking at what we were doing, and they would place orders. And they would buy stuff. We mainly were selling collars, lace collars, handkerchiefs, all little things like that.
And it was a brisk business then?
It was, and they were making money on it. They say it wasn't commercial, but it was. But it was a very secret thing.
Which is odd, because the McAleese report says that the data made available by the nuns suggested that the Magdalene laundries were operated on a subsistence or close to break-even basis, rather than on a commercial or highly profitable basis. The nuns are famously secretive about money, but their old ledgers can turn up in the strangest places. A publican here in Limerick bought a job lot of old furniture from the laundry when it closed and found four ledgers dating back to the 1950s.
Do you get many people asking to look at them?
I don't know.
Pages and pages of private individuals here, hundreds of them. And here the bigger clients, colleges, churches, the Stella Restaurant, the Bedford Hotel, the Railway Hotel. And here, the Limerick Lawn Tennis Club. There wasn't much going on in Limerick where the nuns weren't doing the washing for them.
I found a more recent ledger from 1980 in a museum in Dublin. It's from the High Park Laundry where Mary worked. It reveals even bigger clients, including government contracts.
We have here the airport, one of the country's main train stations, airlines, government departments like the Department of Fisheries. There are hotels, private individuals, convents and seminaries. No wonder trade unions and commercial laundries complained at the time. They were competing against the nuns, whose overheads didn't include wages. They had free forced labour.
And for how long were the women forced to work? According to the McAleese report, the average or median duration of stay in the laundries was approximately 7 months. By comparing headstones with electoral rolls, Claire McGetterick discovered that for one 10-year period, most women at the High Park Laundry were there for a minimum of 8 years.
We've looked at electoral registers, for example, from 1954 to 64, and looking at High Park in particular, we've been able to show that at least 46% of these women from 1954 to 64 never got out. Also, you've got a woman in Limerick who spent 74 years. In 1911, we've got her there at 18 years of age. So, you know, again, it tells a completely different story to that of the McAleese report. And the way the figures are presented is frankly misleading and is not respectful of the lived experience of these women.
And as if to confirm her point, I stumble upon a newly dug grave for a former laundry worker due to be buried the next day. Like these women, she went from working in the laundry to living in the convent.
Another example of how the McAleese inquiry was less than thorough with the figures. They counted as workers in the Magdalene laundries only those who were there when they shut down, forgetting that hundreds had become so institutionalized that they never left. They were there still under the care of the nuns when they died.
I wanted to talk to the nuns about this and other matters. I asked the four main orders involved about the allegations made by Mary and other women, but they all refused to be interviewed. So Mary and I called on the headquarters of the Sisters of Our Lady of Charity in Dublin, where an administrator came to the gate.
Good morning.
Hi, how are you?
Good morning. My name is Sue Lloyd-Roberts. I'm here from the BBC, and this is
Hi,
Mary Merritt, a former Magdalene Laundry worker.
You've already sent in a request, and I think you've got your answer to that
Which
request.
Which is no. We have been refused an interview, but we still have some very important questions to ask.
All I wanted was, please, somebody to give me an apology for what happened to me.
No.
That's all I wanted.
Have you been in touch with our PR people?
We've been in touch with your PR people.
Because
we've been in touch
this
with
is not my job. No. My job is not PR.
Okay.
We were clearly not going to be invited in.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Mary and other survivors are getting compensation from the government for time served in the Magdalene laundries, but they feel betrayed by the report. Senator McAleese turned down my request for an interview. However, the government has apologized, and I was invited to meet Ireland's Deputy Prime Minister, who was herself born to a single mother and put up for adoption by the nuns. Her mother died before she managed to find her.
You know, I recall sitting in kitchens in rural areas of Ireland and women crying and just saying to me, and they had known my birth mother, my birth father, and saying, but things were so different then. It was just so difficult. It was impossible.
When I speak to these women, what they want is the truth to be told.
Well, we now have underway the process for preparing a full judicial report by a very experienced judge who has been involved in
a
number...
So you admit the McAleese inquiry was less than thorough?
Well, the McAleese inquiry was an inquiry at a point in time. I think the critical thing that it achieved was recognition for what women had experienced and what women had gone through.
But the women themselves say it didn't, because, for example, the glossing over of the abuse, the duration of stay...
Well, I would have met personally a huge number of women through my own personal knowledge. And I do know that what is important for a lot of the women is that they would receive a redress payment. And as I said, that's to me is one of the critical things to happen.
The cost of paying compensation, or redress as it's called in Ireland, is expected to run into tens of millions of euros. But those responsible for running the laundries, the nuns, are not being asked to pay. Not only were they making money from the laundries, but after they closed, the nuns made even more from property sales. They now have assets estimated at over 1.5 billion euros. What about the nuns? They have the money. Why aren't they made to pay?
Over the years, property has been forthcoming, but nothing like the amounts of funding and compensation and partaking in the redress scheme to the tune that we would like.
But
that's a continuing conversation. That's a continuing conversation, yes.
That's you when you were a baby.
Oh,
and they took you away from me.
After Mary was raped, she gave birth to a daughter, Carmel.
Yes, I did, yeah.
The baby was taken by the nuns and put up for adoption, and Mary was sent back to work in the laundry. For 40 years, she only had a photo.
You have to keep them forever now.
Oh, I will.
Never let them go.
I'll treasure them.
Yeah.
I will treasure them. They will go into frames.
Mary now lives in the UK. A few years ago, with the help of British social workers, Carmel found her. Mary is desperate to assure her daughter that she didn't give her away willingly.
Carmel, you don't blame me for anything.
No. Oh, God, no, nuts. Don't.
I couldn't. It wasn't my fault.
But we're just not ashamed anymore. That's the end of it. And we are going to speak. And we are going to fight back.
No one has ever been prosecuted. The nuns haven't paid up. And they've been reluctant to find the records which could unite survivors of the mother and baby homes with their families. Now these people await an inquiry into their past.
Justice for our mothers and for the babies to see her.
But the indications are that the new government inquiry will not look again at the laundries.
I would love to get to the real truth, but they won't. They won't inquire properly because I know what the government are like.
They cover up. It's the church and state work together.
I want somebody to apologise to me. The nuns, the church, the priests. Just somebody to apologise to me before I die.
The Second Vatican Council was a plotter's get-together. A robber council, a hijacking, a revolution in the church, certainly to be called illegitimate and void by future Catholic popes. This much became clear to the founder of the Fraternal Society of St. Pius X, Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre. The introduction of the new Mass, religious ecumenism, and an insistence upon the separation of church and state, even in Catholic countries, these and other Masonic innovations made up the core of the new conciliar church, as termed in private by Cardinal Benelli. Although it is true that Archbishop Lefebvre signed the 16 documents of the Second Vatican Council, he quickly repented of it, and for nearly 30 years did all he could in both public and private to make the heretical spirit of the council known to Roman authorities. In 1986, with the first Vatican-sponsored interreligious prayer meeting at Assisi, Lefebvre realized that the authorities were complicit. Rome had erected a new church, founded on the ideals of the Reformation and the Revolution.
Sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. Everything that's wonderful is what I feel when we're together. Brighter than a lucky penny. When you're near, the rain goes, disappears, dear, and I feel so fine. Just to know that you are mine. My life is sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. That's how this refrain goes. So come on, join in. Everybody, sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. Everything that's wonderful is sure to come your way when you're in love to stay.
In 1988, Marcel Lefebvre made a formal act of allegiance to Eternal Rome and consecrated four bishops to the Catholic Church. This act was deemed schismatic by the new Conciliar Church of Vatican II. The Archbishop was not alone in his heroic and defiant act. Bishop Antonio de Castro-Meyer of Campos, Brazil, joined him, saying that it would have been a mortal sin for him not to have been there. Just days after the consecrations, Archbishop Lefebvre wrote to Cardinal Gantin, prefect of the Congregation of Bishops, explaining his actions. He says, "The Catholic faithful have a strict right to know that the priests to whom they have recourse are not in communion with a counterfeit church, which is evolutionary, Pentecostalist, and syncretist." Compare this with the position of the leaders of the SSPX in 2012. Ultimately, from the modern spirit of an unbalanced desire for information and an insistence on a right to know, souls will be led away from Christ's peace. Non-SSPX members, for example the laity, do not have a strict right to be kept informed about the internal affairs of the SSPX, which is a religious congregation. Having faithfully passed on what he had received, Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre now reflected on the relationship between Catholic doctrine and the doctrine of the new church, codified in 1988 in the new Code of Canon Law. He saw with absolute certainty that interpreting the council in the light of tradition was an impossible feat. Before his death on March 25, 1991, Marcel Lefebvre laid down the conditions upon which any future negotiations with Rome could be built. Rome would now have to make an act of faith. Rome would have to return to the church. Till that day, the SSPX and all Catholics everywhere were in survival mode.
Why can't we work out our differences? Why can't we work things out? Why can't we all just get along?
In 1997, the GREC was formed. The members of GREC, or the Group for Reflection Among Catholics, seek to re-establish connections between the SSPX and the new Conciliar Church by setting aside issues of doctrine and engaging in dialogue without anger. GREC is a Novus Ordo think tank founded by Gilbert Perrault, former ambassador of France to Rome, and Father Michel Lelong, a fervent defender of interreligious dialogue as promoted by Vatican II. The goal of GREC, stated in the charter written by Perrault, is to interpret Vatican II in the light of tradition, according to the formula John Paul II gave to Archbishop Lefebvre in 1978. This formula is also known as the Hermeneutic of Continuity of Benedict XVI, or better still, as the Hermeneutic of Rupture, according to Archbishop Lefebvre. Another founder of GREC was SSPX spokesman and editor of the SSPX website, dici.org, Father Alain Laurent. Father Laurent obtained permission from Bishop Follet, Superior General of the SSPX, to participate in GREC's dialogue for a necessary reconciliation. He kept Bishop Follet well informed of the progress of the dialogue. The Fraternity of St. Peter, formed with Rome's approval by priests who abandoned Archbishop Lefebvre at the time of the consecrations in 1988, also took part in the dialogue. It was represented by Father Ribetin, the Fraternity of St. Peter, Superior of France. Later, the head of the Institute of Christ the King joined the dialogue as well. The dialogue focused on a return of the SSPX to full communion. For example, Michel Lelong writes, One can hope that these meetings will lead to an agreement without delay. But the SSPX must understand that if it has much to offer to Rome, it also has much to receive from it. It must therefore stop rejecting Vatican II outright and accept the guiding principles and interpreting them as proposed by the Holy Father today. Why the insistence on reconciliation? Had Rome made an act of faith? No, but that didn't matter. The leaders of the SSPX laid down new conditions. Rather than the act of faith that their founder had insisted be a prerequisite to all talks, they asked instead that the excommunications be lifted and the Latin Mass freed for all priests to say. This, the members of GREC agreed in 2000, would be a sign of good faith on the part of Conciliar Rome. A sign of good faith, maybe. An act of faith, hardly. Instead, an act of faith in Vatican II would be demonstrated in 2012 by Benedict XVI at Assisi III, at which even an atheist representative would participate this time. Atheists, by the way, don't believe in God. The evils of false ecumenism don't seem to matter so much these days, as the Father Laurent-run SSPX website, Dici, made almost no mention of the Communicatio in Sacris. Benedict was traditional, remember? He had issued the motu proprio of 2007, freeing up the Latin Mass. He had followed it up in 2009 with the lifting of the excommunications of the four bishops. Yes, 2009 was meant to be a big year for tradition. Benedict and Bishop Flay were on the brink of a brilliant photo op that would rival all those of John Paul II in the hordes of smiling babies. Hopes were nursed in the breast of many that maybe finally, at last, a traditional bishop would be elevated to the Curia. Traditionalist media outlets like Michael Matt's The Remnant and John Venieri's Catholic Family News were falling all over themselves to make sense of all this tradition coming out of Rome. What could it mean? Yes. That year, all was on course for the reconciliation GREC had longed for. The reconciliation now deemed prudent. The reconciliation that Father Rostand, District Superior of the U.S., would call an act of justice, as though being recognized and approved of by betrayers of our Lord was something one wanted. The reconciliation that Archbishop Lefebvre had called in 1988 Operation Suicide. Yes, everything seemed to be running smoothly ahead. Everything, that is, until...
Between 200,000 and 300,000 Jews perished in Nazi concentration camps, but not one of them by gassing in a gas chamber.
Suddenly, Benedict XVI was afraid to touch the SSPX with a 10-foot pole. His elder brothers were quite upset that the lie of the Holocaust should be exposed so flagrantly by a Catholic bishop. After all, what was the conciliar church if not a conciliatory church? Bishop Fillet had expressed desire to move Bishop Williamson to the sidelines in 1999, just 2 years after GREC's formation. Bishop Williamson, called uranium, a ticking time bomb, and much worse by Father Pfluger and other SSPX leaders, would not be removed from his position as rector at the SSPX seminary in America until 2003. Was he given another top position in the SSPX? No. He was transferred all the way to Argentina in the southern hemisphere of the globe between Chile and Uruguay. Truth has a way of outing itself no matter where it is, and so one may say that it was a fortuitous event when on German soil for a Swedish television production, Bishop Williamson made his candid remarks about the Holocaust, remarks that were perceived by the Conciliar Church as an attack on its elder brothers. This video will not get into the fact that Williamson's remarks are closer to the truth than any you might find coming from mainstream media sources. You may delve into that one on your own. Instead, let us just look at the response of Benedict XVI. Astonishingly, or perhaps not, he says that if he had known Williamson's views on the Shoah, he never would have lifted his excommunication. But, unfortunately, none of us went on the internet to find out what sort of person we were dealing with. Really? Had Benedict been uninformed? As prefect of the Sacred Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith from 1981 to 2005, had he not been the number one middleman for the SSPX in Rome? Had he not commented in written letters to Archbishop Lefebvre on numerous sermons preached by Society priests from pulpits all over the world? And now was he pleading ignorance in the face of Jewish wrath? It was disingenuous at best, dissembling at worst. But none of this came as any surprise to those who had been paying attention.
If the society grows corrupt, then a corrupt deal is easy. If Rome converts, then a deal is also easy. There's no problem, though. If Rome gets back, if the Romans re-understand and get back to the true religion, then the society is their best friend and they've got no more problem with the society. And it's child's play to reintegrate the society into the structures of Rome. But so long as Rome is with the new religion and the society stays with the old, there can only be war between the old religion and the new religion. So either Rome abandons the new religion or the society abandons the old religion. That's what's got to happen before there can be any agreement.
We have our great men and women, and we have some flannel-mouthed fools, too. We all want to live in a better world. We all want to have more. But there's no mystery about what we have or how to lose it. Let's look straight into this one. Let's talk about how to lose what we have and what that would mean to you.
In March 2012, Bishop Fillet wrote in the Society's internal publication, Cor Unum, that Rome's movement towards tradition in recent years demands of us a new position in relation to the official church. This assertion by the Superior General prompted a response by the other three bishops of the SSPX, who wrote to Bishop Fillet on April 7, 2012. Your Excellency, Fathers, take care. You want to lead the society to a point where it will no longer be able to turn back, to a profound division of no return, and, if you end up to such an agreement, it will be with powerful destroying influences who will not keep it. If up until now the bishops of the society have protected it, it is precisely because Monsignor Lefebvre refused a practical agreement. Since the situation has not changed substantially, since the condition prescribed by the chapter of 2006 was by no means carried out, which was a doctrinal change in Rome which would permit practical agreement, at least listen to your founder. It was right 25 years ago. It is right still today. On his behalf, we entreat you. Do not engage the society in a purely practical agreement. Bishop Fillet, Father Pfluger, and Father Naley were the first and second assistants, responded 1 week later. You cannot know how much your attitude over the last few months, quite different for each of you, has been hard for us. It has prevented the Superior General from sharing with you these great concerns, which he would gladly have brought you into, had he not found himself faced with such a strong and passionate lack of understanding. How much he would have loved to be able to count on you, on your advice to undergo this so delicate moment in our history. It is a great trial, perhaps the greatest of all 18 years of his being superior. Our venerable founder gave to the society bishops a task and precise duties. He made clear that the principle of unity in our society is the superior general. But for a certain time now, you have been trying, each one of you in his own way, to impose on him your point of view, even in the form of threats, and even in public. This dialectic between the truth and the faith on the one side and authority on the other is contrary to the spirit of the priesthood. He might at least have hoped that you were trying to understand the arguments driving him to act as he had acted these last few years in accordance with the will of divine providence. What did this mean? Had the three bishops been remiss in showing their superior general the love? Or had Bishop Fillet simply changed the course of the ship and accused his shipmates of lacking supernatural spirit and realism? Actually, that was it precisely. Your collective letter suffers from two faults with regard to the reality of the church. It is lacking both in supernatural spirit and in realism. Bishop Williamson, Bishop Tissier, and Bishop de Galarreta lacking in realism, or rather lacking in Grec sensibilities. One day after responding to the three bishops, Bishop Fillet sent a doctrinal preamble to Rome, which outlined all that he was willing to do in order to be officially recognized by the conciliar church. Among the many weak stances put forward in the preamble is this one. The affirmations of the Second Vatican Council and of the later Pontifical Magisterium relating to the relationship between the Church and the non-Catholic Christian confessions, as well as the social duty of religion and the right to religious liberty, whose formulation is with difficulty reconcilable with prior doctrinal affirmations from the Magisterium, must be understood in the light of the whole uninterrupted tradition in a manner coherent with the truths previously taught by the Magisterium of the Church, without accepting any interpretation of these affirmations whatsoever that would expose Catholic doctrine to opposition or rupture with tradition and with the Magisterium. Sounds like a victory for Grec. What would Archbishop Lefebvre have to say about Vatican II's stance on religious liberty? Let's open religious liberty questioned and find out. On the first page of the introduction, the question is posed. Can the conciliar declaration on religious liberty, Dignitatis Humanae, be reconciled with the traditional doctrine of the Church? The answer is no. The words of Archbishop Lefebvre are clear. I do not believe that the declarations of the Council on liberty of conscience, liberty of thought, and liberty of religion can be compatible with the popes taught in the past. Therefore, we have to choose. Either we choose what the popes have taught for centuries, and we choose the Church, or we choose what was said by the Council. But we cannot choose both at the same time, since they are contradictory. Have the leaders of the SSPX adopted a contradictory position? Yes. But that's not all it's done. Since 2012, it has expelled, locked its doors on, silenced, cut off, or charged with leaving every priest who has voiced any concern whatsoever over this change of course. These priests include Father Girard, Father Chazal, Father Pfeiffer, Father Libiatis, Father Hugo, Father Voigt, Father Ringrose, Father Arizaga, Father Ortiz, Father Ruiz, Father Riolt, Father Trincado, Father Thomas Aquinas, Father Zabi, Father Cardoza, as well as the Carmelite nuns of Germany, and of course Bishop Williamson, the only one of the three bishops to still be putting up a fight, and others who prefer to be unnamed for the moment. The question, however, is not how could the leaders of the SSPX cast so many good priests, but rather, why are there not more priests speaking out? The day that the SSPX abandons the spirit and rules of its founder, it will be lost. Has that day come? Since the SSPX has abandoned the spirit, is it time for us to abandon the SSPX? Consider for a moment, why would Bishop Fillet want a deal so badly? Why is the SSPX considered to be outside the Church, but Pope Francis has no problem calling Muslims his brothers on Good Friday? Our Lady of Fatima insists that Russia be consecrated. The SSPX used to insist that this had not yet happened. Does it still do so today? Will it continue to do so after being welcomed into the fold of the new conciliar Church? These questions and many more are yours to ask. Don't let anyone tell you that you shouldn't be troubled. Watch and pray, says our Lord.